Catherine Calloway. She's joining us from the command center for this search in Glenwood. And Catherine, do the searchers have any idea how many people they may be looking for?
They have no idea. We've had estimates as many as 300 people were in this camping area, but they really don't know. A lot of the registration papers were washed away. They were just estimating how many are usually in the area this time of year. I should tell you, we're just a little ways down the road from that command center. I did go to the Red Cross Center a little while ago and spoke with some of the family members, some of the victims. Their heartbreaking stories as they have been waiting all night long for these search efforts to continue. They are well underway now. They are in the air. They are on all-terrain vehicles. A lot of local residents have brought in their ATVs, and they're searching, as well as on horseback. They're even in canoes trying to find more survivors and possible victims in this case. But as you say, the trouble, they still have no idea just how many people they're searching for. Me?
Desperate families best to cope as officials search for the missing from Friday's horrific flash flooding at a campground in western Arkansas. Ginger Autry awoke to a phone call informing her that her teenage son was among those unaccounted for. He'd been camping with other relatives.
I just want my baby. That's all I want. I just want to see his little face.
Although officials say a flash flood warning was issued for the area at 2 a.m., most here were sleeping and were caught unaware. Listen to one witness describe what it was like when the Little Missouri River began to swell, filling the lower-lying campground like a bowl.
Around here, the pavilion, this place over here, the kitchen was destroyed. The bars moved around, the giant refrigerator's knocked over. In the office, the refrigerator that had in there was floating.
While he got out safely, for others still waiting for news, they will never be able to look at the area in the same way again.
It's the most horrific thing I've ever been through in my life.
We have spoken with a couple of the family members up at the Red Cross Center down the street, and it was a very long night as they were waiting again for those efforts to continue, the search efforts to continue. We have heard some heartbreaking stories. One, a man told us that when he arrived on the scene yesterday, the first thing he saw was a young two-year-old who had been fished from the river. And I spoke with another woman who said she's has several family members missing. It is going to be a very long day, but we're trying to remember that 30 people were found yesterday, were rescued yesterday, and we're hoping to get that same type of news today.
We certainly hope so. Thank you so much, Catherine. Earlier this morning, we spoke with a Red Cross worker about the survivors, and she tells us people woke up to an awful scene.
We heard numerous stories of mothers that were holding tight to babies. Unfortunately, some were swept away. So as you can imagine, these families are in shock. They're stunned. They're not eating, and so that is one of our biggest focuses right now is to get people to eat and drink and keep their energy up.
We're going to bring in Jackie Jarris, meteorologist, here to explain exactly what happened, because this caught so many people by surprise. Mm-hmm. That I was asking you, was there a forecasted warning? We know there was a warning at 2 a.m., but was there a forecast for this?
There was a flood watch, which means conditions are favorable for flooding, and we did know that heavy rain was going to be coming into the area, but I don't think anything expected this much rain in such a short period of time, and the ground was already really, really saturated. There you can see on Doppler radar, the pink area that we're looking at, that's estimating between 6 and 7 inches of rain that fell in a 24-hour period. And much of this actually really fell in about a 3-hour period. And part of the problem is, you know, a lot of places in the U.S. can absorb and handle that much rain, but this area can't. And here's why. Take a look at this Google Earth, and you can see the terrain in the area. Look at all the hills. And then down here, the campground is into the valley, and there you can see the river, which runs through it in the area. So all of the rain that's collected on the mountainsides and the hillsides, this all runs down into the valley, fills up all the rivers and creeks, and just elevates them really, really quickly. Now, the creek in this area, by the way, rose 20 feet, 20 feet, and that's 10 feet above the record, to just help put it into perspective. And atmospherically, what happened is we had an area of high pressure down here into the Gulf of Mexico, and what that does is it brings winds in from the Gulf up towards Arkansas. So that brings in all kinds of moisture, and things were very, very ripe for showers and thunderstorms to develop. A little area of low pressure came through here, rode very slowly around that high, and brought that heavy rainfall. It was a cluster of thunderstorms. It's what we call an MCS, or a mesoscale convective system, and they tend to bring a lot of heavy rain and sometimes severe weather along with it. And here's an example of what we would call an MCS. It's moving across the upper Midwest right now. This is producing some very heavy rainfall. Their flood watch is in effect here across parts of Nebraska and Iowa. So this is the time of the year that we see systems like that, but certainly very unusual to get that much rain in such a short period of time and such a devastating outcome.
Sure is, Jackie. Thanks for that.